In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title for the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God, they are titles, they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and God's many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is inscrutable and incomprehensible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being. That is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested Himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that He walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, He instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where He showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates. According to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose operating through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today, we will have a scripture lesson of Job chapter 1, and that will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser. We will have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas, and that will be followed by a selection of music.
Good evening, class. It's a time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for make possible for us to be here to praise you, learn your purpose, your plan of salvation, which is the most important thing. Thank you for make that avenue for us, knowing you, and try to find out if you really are and actually exist. We are for sure. We know that with the those signs and this teaching you give us through the founder, Henry Clifford Kinley, we're on the right track. So I say all those things in your only son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah. Thank you.
Good evening, class. The scripture lesson will be taken from Job, the first chapter, page 643. I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities in various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainum. Job's, the first chapter, page 643. There was a man in the land of Uz, whose name was Job, and that man was perfect and upright, and one that feared Elohim and eschewed evil. And there were born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters. His substance also was 7,000 sheep and 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 she-asses, and a very great household, so that this man was the greatest of all the men of the East. And his sons went and feasted in their houses, every one his day, and sent and called for their 3 sisters to eat and to drink with them. And it was so, when the days of their feasting was done, gone about, that Job sent and sanctified them, and rose up early in the morning, and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, "It may be that my sons have sinned, and cursed Elohim in their hearts." Thus did Job continually. Now there was a day when the sons of Elohim came to present themselves before Yahweh, and Satan came also among them. And Yahweh said unto Satan, "Whence comest thou?" Then Satan answered Yahweh and said, "From going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it." And Yahweh said unto Satan, "Hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth Elohim and escheweth evil?" Then Satan answered Yahweh and said, "Doth Job fear Elohim for naught? Hast not thou made a hedge about him, and about his house, and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land. But put forth thy hand now, and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face." And Yahweh said unto Satan, "Behold, all that he hath is in thy power. Only upon himself put not forth thy hand." So Satan went forth from the presence of Yahweh. And there was a day when his sons and his daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house. And there came a messenger unto Job and said, "The oxen were plowing and the asses feeding beside them. And the Sabines fell upon them and took them away. Yea, they have slain the servants with the edge of the sword, and I only am escaped along to tell thee." While he was yet speaking, there came another, and said, "The fire of Elohim is fallen from heaven, and has burned up the sheep and the servants, and consumed them, and I only am escaped along to tell thee." While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, "The Chaldeans made out 3 bands and fell upon the camels and have carried them away, yea, and slayed the servants with the edge of the sword, and I only am escaped along to tell thee." While he was yet speaking, there came another and said, "Thy sons and thy daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house, and behold, there came a great wind from the wilderness and smote the 4 corners of the house, and it fell upon the young men, and they are dead, and I only am escaped along to tell thee." Then Job arose and rent his mantle and shaved his head and fell down upon the ground and worshipped and said, "Naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. Yahweh gave, and Yahweh has taken away. Blessed be the name of Yahweh." And all this Job sinned not, nor charged Elohim foolishly. I have read Job, the 1st chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Salas, and thank you, Dr. Reiser. For our first speaker this evening, I would like to call the dean, a of the Ontario branch, Dr. Marlon Love.
That's cool. Good evening, class.
Good evening.
How's everybody doing?
Well.
Enjoying some wet weather today. Able to get off a little bit early today, so it was good to enjoy the fresh air, if you would, the cleanliness of California anyways. And welcome, like the prayer said, welcome again to class in order to learn more perfectly about the things that we've come to learn about Yahweh our Elohim by way of his son Yahshua the Messiah. I always enjoy the chapter of Job and the story by which Job expresses, according to the purpose of Yahweh. Can you grab that first chapter of Job and get down to where it talks about that raven, if you would? And then when Satan comes on the scene there and kind of mocks Yahweh for, as he saw it, protecting him or having a hedge around Job.
Now there was a day when the sons of Elohim came to present themselves before Yahweh, and Satan came also among them.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh said unto Satan, whence comest thou? Then Satan answered Yahweh and said, from going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it. And okay. Yahweh said,
that's good.
Okay.
You got that Satan, or that mystery of iniquity, being amongst the sons of Elohim, right? Is what it said, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you have that mystery of iniquity right there in the midst of the sons of Yahweh. You grab me Genesis over there with Noah. We have another something else that was running around, Genesis 8 and 7. And he sent forth this raven into the earth. That's what I want.
Genesis 8 and 7. Mm-hmm. And he sent forth a raven which went forth to and fro until the waters was dried up from off the earth.
Now he sent that raven out twice, right? He sent that raven out and it came back. And he sent it again to and fro, living on the carcassness or the souls of men, or died, you know, or living off the flesh, if you would. It was what that raven depicted. Mm-hmm. And that's why that raven didn't come back. That dove came back with that olive branch in order to show that given life that was upon, or they say the raven was eating the souls that were lost in the flood.
Right.
The bodies that were lost in the flood, carnivorous, eating the carnality of man. And just like Satan does, get into one's heart and mind by way of their consciousness and beguiling them and making them do things what they ought not do according to a spirit of Yahshua the Messiah, which we're come here to class in order to learn more perfectly about. There's other denominations that purport to have, even we have the pamphlet here, it says the clergy has ignorantly called Yahshua, the Messiah, a liar, right? By saying that he instituted rather than fulfilled the carnal ordinances. They also ignorantly profess and declare the name that they want to choose to call him being Lord, right? And whereby we understand that Lord, just grammatically so, is a title. The etymology of the word Lord is a title. God's the same thing. So again, doctrines come up with false information and they put off onto the souls of men just like that ravenous raven does or did, and just like Satan did amongst the sons of Yahweh, going to and fro, scavenging on whomever they might be able to scavenge on. And so it's by having the information that we understand that that raven was set up, instituted to have demonstrated this principle. We don't have a 40 plate of Job, do we? Do we?
No.
We don't. That was interesting. That was a big story, and we don't have a plate of that. Nevertheless, we did have it read there in the scripture, or in the prophets, if you would, of Job, talking about this raven. Give me Psalms 22 and 13. Please.
Psalms 22, 13.
I think so. I sent it forth.
What you looking for?
Psalms 22, 13.
The gaps upon
they,
you.
They, ga- without they gaped mouth. Upon me with their mouths as a raven, as a ravening, and a roaring lion. That's what you want?
Yeah.
Okay.
But I think I want to catch the continuity, but it's up a little ways. Start at one.
Okay.
You got a minute.
Psalms 22.
Uh huh.
My El, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me, and from the words? Excuse me.
Want me to get it?
From the words of my roaring. Oh, my Elohim, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not, and in the night season, and am not silent. But thou art holy, and thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in thee. They trusted, and thou didst deliver them. They cried unto thee, and were delivered.
They cried. They were crying down there in Egypt. Is that right? That's what David's talking about, because we understand that if we're reading the law and the prophets are drawn out of what Moses wrote, which was his first five books. So we're not telling any other story. So we have David espousing about how he, how the hand of Yahweh delivered the children of Israel unto Canaan's land. That's what was part of the promise that was given to Abraham.
Right.
That he's going to bring them down in the land they know not of, and then return them here into Jerusalem or Palestine and give them an inheritance. That part was done. There was still the fulfillment of the promise, though, right? Because it's by the seed of Yahshua the Messiah, but it's going to be fulfilled through us by way of that Holy Spirit or Pentecost, of having a revelation of what one Yahshua the Messiah was all about and the promise that was given unto Abraham. So there's different things being fulfilled and being brought to the end so we can have a clarity of what Solomon or David is talking about here. Continue on, please.
Fifth verse. They cried unto thee and were delivered. They trusted in thee and were not confounded. But I am a worm and no man, a reproach of man, and despise of the people, and despised of the people, excuse me. All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip. They shake the head, saying, he trusted on Yahweh that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighteth in him. But thou art he that took me out of the womb. Thou didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breast. I was cast upon thee from the womb. Thou art my El from my mother's belly. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help. Many bulls have compassed me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me round. They gaped upon me with their mouths as a ravening and a roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws, and thou hast brought me into the dust of death. For dogs have compassed me. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. I may count all my bones. They look and stare upon me. They part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. But be not thou far from me, O Yahweh. O my strength, haste thee to help me. Deliver my soul from the sword, my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, for thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorns. I will declare my name.
Unicorns.
Is that?
Unicorns. You have unicorns in the Bible some 9 to 7 times. You have unicorns 3 times. And we can look that up in a minute. And you have unicorn about 7 to 9 times throughout there. And it simply is an ox.
Right.
That was an ox that they used at the time to plow their fields. Mm. And it's by the horns that they had on those oxes. Mm-hmm. How the translator translated to be a singular instead of pluralistic is an unknown thing.
Well, because they had the bone went all the way across the
right.
top.
Right. It looked like one unicorn.
Yeah. There was 2 horns that came out the side, but there was the bone.
The big bone that's in the front.
Yeah.
So they they just made that statement there. Because I even looked up the 1611 one, and it just has the U change. It still said it that way. So it's in principle, it's not a mystical horse with a big tusk in the front of his head. In the Greek mythology, which was down there with the Greeks, with Plato and Socrates and all them, when they was just coming up with ideas, because they wrote it singular here. Just like Sean said, it was the big bone that the oxes had.
There's also, I looked that up as well, there is proof of animals like rhinos singular horn coming straight out.
Ox. Yeah, because you read there with that, and we can grab it, you know, after we're going to run down through this raven as far as feeding off the flesh, and that's just what David is talking about here in Psalms, and how he gaped him with their mouths open as ravenous and roaring lion. That's not raven, but that's raving and roaring lion. I think I wanted 147:9. He giveth to the beast his food, and to the young ravens. I lost it.
Yeah, yeah, that's 147:9. He giveth to the beast his food, and to the young ravens which cry. He delighteth not in the strength of the horse. He taketh not pleasure in the legs of a man.
He's just dealing with the flesh. Basically, again, with raven. Grab a Luke 12 and 24. Mm-hmm.
Luke 12:24. Mm-hmm. Consider the ravens, mm-hmm. for they neither sow nor reap, mm-hmm. which neither have storehouse nor barn.
They're not preparing for anything. And this raven that Noah let out, he's not trying to sow or trying to bring back anything. He was getting his. He was able to get and eat, partake of it, all that he wanted. Because remember that Satan was let loose for a little hour. When he was let loose down here on earth, he was going to be able to perform all the things he wanted to do down here on earth. That's why Job was given unto Satan, if you would, to see, hey, how's he going to act if Yahweh don't have him girded? And that he will partake and he will blaspheme the name, because that's what Satan wanted him to do, was to blaspheme his name. And his wife said, why don't you just blaspheme the old Yahweh and die? But yet, because of what's on Saul's heart, because Job's heart, because it said in the first chapter there, Job, what does it say? The first verse, first chapter?
There was a man in the land of Uz, uh-huh. whose name was Job.
Yes.
And that man was perfect and upright and one that feared Elohim.
That's what we have to do. That's how we have to be. And he feared Elohim the whole time down through. He was having his problems, because we read on there with Job, you know, Satan put it on him. Mm-hmm. Took his whole family away, took his oxes away, his business away. And he was a beat man with boils and everything else. And he had three friends in his ears being a ravenous within their consciousness, trying to get him to turn and not fear Yahweh Elohim, you know. And being perfect, because once you understand it according to the perfect will of Yahweh, this gospel can't slip from you unless you've been learned in vain, learned without it being consciously sealed within you, by which you understand the death, burial, and resurrection, and have a keen belief in the law, prophets, and the fulfillment, and how you can not have that satanic nature slip back in unawares, is what we have to be mindful of when we're reading the scriptures and going through the scriptures. And it's by not partaking, because even Saul talks about little children, keep yourself from evil. Well, what Saul's making that statement, I think that's fifth chapter, the last verse. I know it's the last verse of one of those. Keep from evil. John 17 and 15. I think it says there.
John 17:15. I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but thou shouldest keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world,
mm-hmm.
even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth, because thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so I also sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through mm-hmm. their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me.
So you being perfect, if you go by way of Yahshua the Messiah, learning the things that we've come to learn about this tabernacle that was shown unto Moses atop of Mount Sinai in his second trip, and how this tabernacle is set up and lines up with everything in the known universe, starting from as small as the atom to the cell to morning, noon, and night, and how everything's broken up into three parts in order to give us witnesses unto the perfection of Yahshua the Messiah. And it's a beautiful thing when those things are clearly understood. And like, let's go ahead and find the unicorn real quick, because it was a question that was brought to my attention. And what I'm going to want is Deuteronomy, Psalms, and then Isaiah 34. So Deuteronomy 33 and 17, you can write them down. Psalms 22 and 21, and then Isaiah 34 and 7. And looking at Deuteronomy being a part of the law, we can read in here about unicorns real quick.
You want Deuteronomy 33, 17?
But we're going to start and go to 13.
Deuteronomy 33, 13.
Mm-hmm.
And of Joseph he said, mm-hmm. Blessed of Yahweh be his land for the precious things of heaven, for the dew and for the deep that coucheth beneath,
mm-hmm.
and for the precious fruits brought forth by the sun, and for the precious things put forth by the moon,
mm-hmm.
and for the chief things of the ancient mountains, and for the precious things of the lasting hills, and for the precious things of the earth and fullness thereof, and for the good will of him that dwelt in the bush. Let the blessing come upon the head of Joseph,
mm-hmm.
and upon the top of the head of him that was separated from his brethren.
And that's Joseph that was up here in Canaan's land before they came down into Egypt, right? Because we know that Joseph was the son that Jacob loved and was given the coat of many colors. Mm-hmm. And there's going to be a promise that's going to be given unto Joseph, whereby Joseph is going to be evilly entreated by his brothers, mm-hmm. brought down into Egypt, mm-hmm. and he was going to be given that mantle, if you would, or be anointed as a second in command to right. Pharaoh down here in Egypt. Mm-hmm. This is what we're reading here. Read.
His glory is like the firstling of his bullock.
Bullock being an ox, right? Read.
And his horns are like the mm-hmm. horns of unicorns.
And we were talking about that unicorn earlier. That it was just that one horn or that big bone across that ox. That's what they had. Keep reading.
With them he shall push the people together to the ends of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And they are the 10,000s of Ephraim.
Uh-huh.
And they are the thousands of Manasseh.
He's going to push them. That's what you use with a plow in order to pull and push mm-hmm. to hole or furrow the ground. And where else do we find that ox? And who else is push? Who's the only one doing pushings and pulling around here by way of having this creation that he created? What's his name?
Elohim.
Elohim. What's the O stand for?
Ox.
That's the ox. Mm-hmm. That by which Joseph is a type of, because he was going to be given full reign down here in Egypt, whereby he's going to be able to prophesy about a land or a famine that was going to come about. He's the one pushing and governing where these people are going to go.
Right.
And they came down here. 70 souls came down into Egypt, but they ended up multiplying. And it was by way of Elohim that's doing that. The O, or that ox. And that's what that ox is representing in what they've termed unicorn. But
right.
it is that ox within Yahweh Elohim that's pushing. Mm-hmm. Yes, Doc? You got a mic?
Yes.
Just give him this one right here, man. He all right. There we go. I think that worked. Go ahead.
Ephraim.
This one. Yep.
Ephraim, he carried the flag of the hawks.
Ephraim.
Ephraim.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Ephraim. The one that replaced Ephraim and Phinehas, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there is three tribes on top of the tabernacle.
Yes.
And the one in charge was Ephraim. And those three tribes, carry the ox flag.
Mm-hmm.
And other ones have the man flag, the eagle flag, and Judah.
The lion.
Judah, the lion mm-hmm. flag. Yeah.
Yeah, they don't have the particular flag. But you said it was Ephraim?
Yeah.
Had the ox.
Yeah.
That was to the west, right?
Mm-hmm.
West, and this was east.
Yeah, Judah was the east.
Judah was the east, yeah.
Yeah, correct.
What flag did Judah have?
Judah, recall? Lion.
He had the lion, the tribe of Judah.
Yeah.
And then the ox was, what would you say, Ephraim?
Ephraim.
And then man was Dan in the south.
Yeah. And
the eagle was Reuben.
Reuben, yeah, was the man.
Reuben was the man.
Yeah.
And Dan was the eagle?
Eagle.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Very good. So we have that understanding. Just go ahead and keep reading if you still have it. You still have that spot?
Well, I'll start back at 17.
Yeah, it's fine.
His glory is like the firstling of his bullock, and his horns are like the horns of unicorns. With them he shall push the people together to the ends of the earth.
That's good. That's the Elohim going to be doing that, right? Mm-hmm. And you got Psalms 22:21. David again?
Yeah. 22:21. Save me from the lion's mouth, for thou hast heard me from the horn of the unicorns.
Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
I will declare thy name unto my brethren.
So you're going to have to still declare the name of Yahweh to his brethren. That's what mm-hmm. David's talking about. Talking about a lion. Talking about that tribe of Judah, right? Mm-hmm. That's going to have to come up out of that tribe in order to keep reading. To declare declare his name, because that's what Yahweh did when he came in. He didn't come in to institute. He's come in to fulfill that which he set up. And what's the first thing that we find out that we are say that in the school that is instituted? Is a name given unto Moses. Mm-hmm. And that was that name that Yahweh said he's going to do with this thing with this people. He's going to want them to show him his power mm-hmm. and his name. He instituting that right here with David say you're going to continue to do. Read.
I will declare thy name
yep.
unto my brethren.
Yep. He's not coming up with no new talk. He's looking right back here mm-hmm. in Exodus about what Moses said or what Yahweh said about his name. Mm-hmm. They gave him a name of the Ten Commandments. That was the first law.
Right.
Thou shalt not take Yahweh thy or Yahweh's name in vain.
Right.
You follow? And so if we understand that was the first of this marriage vow that we have with this covenant that transpired here with this people and this people alone, that his name was going to be something important. Well, David's saying the same thing.
Right.
Reread and go, please.
I will declare thy name unto my brethren.
Uh-huh.
In the midst of the congregation will I praise thee.
Mm-hmm.
Ye that fear Yahweh, praise him.
And then didn't Job fear Yahweh?
Yep.
Now you got another perfect one. In by way of Job, that's going to have a fear of Yahweh. Mm-hmm. Yahweh Elohim, as we read it there with Job. Keep reading, Eunice.
Ye that fear Yahweh, mm-hmm. praise him. All ye the seed of Jacob, mm-hmm. glorify him and fear him. All ye the seed of Israel. For he hath...
Go ahead.
For he hath not despised nor abhorred mm-hmm. the affliction of the afflicted,
mm-hmm.
neither has he hid his face from him.
Mm-hmm.
But when he cried unto him,
yes.
he heard.
When he cried, when they cried down here in Egypt, this is what David's expressing, when they cried, mm-hmm. he heard. And he was down here himself as Oshea, the son of Nun.
That's right.
Hearing and witnessing unto their misery,
yeah.
until what they had to endure. And he said, and told Moses that he's come down and he's heard and saw his people,
mm-hmm.
right? And so this is what David's expressing by way of unicorns, as it all expressed there. But it was that ox or that Elohistic individual that's down here tearing, or that's in and out. That's what we say the spirit is, writing to whomever he might write it unto for them to write the word of Yahweh, right? Mm-hmm. And that's what David does all down throughout the divisions of Psalms. Isaiah 34:7, and might start up a little bit. Start at,
I don't want to go to one.
Five.
Yeah, it's fine.
Oh, go one?
No, start at five. Okay. It's fine.
For my words shall be bathed in heaven. Behold, it shall come down upon Iduam and upon the people of my curse to judgment. The sword of Yahweh is filled with blood. It is made fat with the fatness and with the blood of the lambs and goats, with the fat of the kidneys of rams. For Yahweh hath a sacrifice in Bora and a great slaughter in the land of Idume.
This is Isaiah writing of the word of Yahweh. Read.
And the unicorns shall come down with them.
That's the ox is going to come down with them. Read.
And the bullocks with the bulls. And their land shall be soaked with blood, and their dust made fat with fatness. For it is the day of Yahweh's vengeance, and the year of recompense for the controversy of Zion. And the streams thereof shall be turned into pitch, and the dust thereof into brimstone, and the land thereof shall become burning pitch. It shall not be quenched night nor day. The smoke thereof shall go up forever. From generation to generation it shall lie waste. None shall pass through it forever and ever. Go ahead.
No, that's good. Okay. That's good. So we get the idea about the ox. Just want to make clear the unicorn. Someone had asked that question previously.
I've got a definition from Wikipedia.
A wild ox? But go ahead.
So I did a search. I did a search for unicorn in Hebrew. And it comes up as re-m, R-E apostrophe.
R-E apostrophe E-M.
E-M.
Uh-huh.
And if in Wikipedia, it reads, a re-m, also rem, in Hebrew, is an animal mentioned seven times in the Hebrew Bible. It has been translated as unicorn in the King James Version. And in some Christian Bible translation as oryx, which was accepted as the referent in modern Hebrew. A wild ox, wild bull, buffalo, or rhinoceros.
Yeah.
That's all I
got. And then even if you take that Hebrew character and then you search that Hebrew character, then it's going to come up and show you an animal with a like a 3 foot long horn. Now, not one horn, but you know, it's two, like a deer or some kind of range animal. It's an African animal. With a longer horn, but there's two of them.
Yeah, the orcs.
So the orcs.
Yeah, got to make sure you say that. Right,
so that was kind of interesting. I seen it. Oh, for the camera?
Yeah,
that's fine.
It's okay.
They can look it up. No, I'm talking about the bone. This is how they, this is how the writer, who are the translator, wrote it. They just took it in their interpretation. And not even a unicorn, just a uni means one. And that bone that was there, you know, they had that one bone in the center. And it was that ox that was plowing in the furlough. Because you read down through one of those chapters, it talks about how that unicorn's gonna plow and it's gonna furrow the ground in order for them to harvest and whatnot. You got something, Samuel? I know you got a lot of tricks. Oh.
You had the four flags in there, the tribes.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Ephraim.
Yeah, Reuben, the man. And then Dan, you have the eagle. And then Judah, the lion here. And then you have, you see this bone? This is that bone that you're talking about, that hard, because it's really, it goes all the way across, but that's a hard bone. And it looks like a bone. That's what it is. And that was that one that he, expressing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then what was that? And we know how on this tabernacle, we know that this is west, right? And we know that this is east, mm-hmm. because we know that this always had to be light in the holy place. Mm-hmm. And so when we know that they put out the candlestick light at 9 in the morning and they lit it at 3 in the afternoon, so we can always know, orientate ourselves according to where we're at with this tabernacle. And then I've always expressed that the north is on the side of the light and the table of shewbread was the side of the south. As far as where, you know, not that we're moving the tabernacle around, but that's how that was would be set up. Mm-hmm. And because they were moving it all the days, 40 years around here in the wilderness. Mm-hmm. So we went through that. Okay. Anybody else have anything? Okay. Oh, that's fine. I think we did go over the number 7 in the holy place. Do we read the what denotes perfection? We did that one.
Where we at?
The textbook here. I'm just gonna.
Just a little side note, since we're going over in number 7, that appears 735 times in the Bible, just as much as water, 722.
Of the word 7?
7. The number 7 shows up 735 times.
And that's the most of one word you said? Or more than the
water shows up 722 times.
Oh, wow. Interesting. Tabernacle. So I'm looking at. See if we can find some more on a tabernacle. Volume 3 of the good textbook here about the physical body. We can also express, you got 9 primary vessels, correct? In this body or in this tabernacle. And to express the tabernacle, you have 3 parts, a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout, with 3 primary vessels in each one of these compartments. The 3 primary vessels in this court roundabout are of all of brass. We have the brazen altar of sin sacrifice, the brazen laver, and a cup of a holy anointing oil. In the holy place, we have the 7 branch candlestick, table of shewbread, and the altar of incense. And then in the most holy place, we have the Ark of the Covenant, which is a 3-in-1 configuration, all melted and beaten together, comprising of the one or the unity of the Spirit, right, with the 2 archangels on the mercy seat covering the covenant. And within this covenant, you have the table, the law, the 10 commandment law, Aaron's rod that budded, and also the manna. Okay, and then with the 9, it correlates here with the body by way of the 9 primary nervous systems, right? You have the reproductive system, the nervous system, the reproductive system, the endocrine system, the respiratory system. So those 3, the nervous system, I'll write it down. Just so the viewers might see, be interested. And actually, we got on that big chart up there. The nervous system, the reproductive,
The endocrine,
And this is correlating with the nine vessels. The respiratory.
Attributes.
Circulatory, right? The excretory, the digestive. Now we're down the court roundabout, right? Because your intestines, digestive, muscular. That's your power and strength, right? Your muscular. And then the skeleton. The skeletal. So those nine functions are going with the nine vessels that we have. We just went over in the tabernacle.
What page are you reading on in the
book? 15, volume 3, 15. Can we read that paragraph above there, Eunice?
15.
Mm-hmm.
Man in his physiological makeup is controlled and functions by nine systems, which are perfectly and harmoniously balanced within his body. Although the effects of each of these systems is manifested throughout the whole body, each can be arranged in a fashion similar to the furnishing of the tabernacle.
Now, also, you've got nine primary attributes,
right?
As well, right? You got
right.
nine furnishings, we got nine systems, and we have nine divine attributes. Mm-hmm. Understanding that these attributes are arranged in a particular order, as Dr. Kennedy is expressing there, that the order is perfect in how they were designed. Mm-hmm. Understanding that intelligence is first, according to wisdom and knowledge, right? And we're going to have beauty, which is going to be at the head of love and justice. And then we're going to have power, which is trumps the foundation and strength, which they do all work together. Yeah, Blake 2, I knew it was there. I don't bring them both. I guess they're hand in hand. Yes, sir.
And there is another thing.
Go.
There is a nine planets and a solar system.
There's nine planets in the solar system.
And the fourth planet called Mars is called the red planet.
The red planet, number four. Meaning the red man of Yahshua coming in on the fourth dispensation.
And the sacrifice in the altar.
Huh?
The blood and the altar or sacrifice also.
Yes. And the fourth dispensation. And the fourth day that he came in on the sun.
Perfect, exactly.
Yeah, and Earth is being three, right? It's three planets away from the sun, correct? And so Mars being the fourth, you have the nine planets, and this is what I was talking about, how what Eunice just read, how they're put in order according to intelligence. Intelligence is flanked by wisdom and knowledge. Beauty is flanked by love and justice. And then foundation is flanked by power and strength, which is wrapped up within the kingdom. And so this is how these nine attributes are going to be read down here about the system. Go ahead and read, Eunice, please.
Attributes. And the attributes of those super incorporeal form. The nine systems of man's physical body are as follows. 1, nervous system. 2, reproductive system.
Yes.
3, endocrine system or glandular system. Respiratory system. 5, circulatory system. 6, excretory system. 7, digestive system. And 8, muscular system. And 9, skeletal system. When these nine systems are grouped in the fashion as the furnishing of the tabernacle and the attributes of the super incorporeal form, the arrangement would be as follows.
And that's what we put on the board there. So go ahead and skip on down to this grouping of systems.
This grouping of the systems of the physical body in a fashion similar to the furnishing of the tabernacle and as the attributes of the superincorporeal form is not without a definite and concise explanation. We will compare each system of the physical body in the arrangement set forth above to each attribute of Elohim, superincorporeal form. As divine intelligence is the crown of the superincorporeal form and is the highest attribute ruling over all of the other attributes.
So we're saying that, or Dr. Kinney is saying that intelligence is the crown. Is from out of intelligence, just like the baby is created first by his head. When you're creating a child, and then within this child, the head is created first and then the body. Okay? Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
And coordinating their functions. So the nervous system of the physical body dominates, commands, and coordinates all of the other systems of the physical body. Yahweh is intelligence himself, and this intelligence supersedes all other intelligences, whether it be of angels or of man. Isaiah 55:8-9, 1 Corinthians 2:16. Likewise, there must be a physical manifestation in our bodies to show forth this attribute. So our nervous system, through which our mind function, is the highest system of our bodies. The fullness capacity and capacities of our nervous system have not been discovered, neither does any man know the depth or the intelligence of Yahweh. From divine intelligence stems divine wisdom and knowledge working as a pair and manifesting the next highest degree of excellence. Remember, each attribute is perfect within itself. David wrote of the wisdom and knowledge, understanding of Yahweh, and recognized their excellence. One needs only to think of the polytechnical makeup and operation of the universe or the physical body to make him declare the superiority of their awesome pair. Keep going.
That was a pair of what? Of knowledge and power, or knowledge and wisdom?
Wisdom and knowledge.
Yeah.
Working as a pair.
Do we have another group setting?
The corresponding system of the physical body, which are paired together to bring about a high degree of excellence and performance, second only to the nervous system, are the reproductive and endocrine systems. Is there a greater degree of attainment than the ability to create or reproduce oneself? This is accomplished by means of the reproductive system and the endocrine system working together in their capacities and forming an inseparable bond. The reproductive system never forgets how to produce the same copy, and the endocrine system supplies the stimulus and substance for each copying or reproduction and maintenance.
So those two working together, just like wisdom and knowledge work together in the same perfect state, coming from out of pure intelligence, just like that nervous system supersedes all other systems. And you can just read them straight down of what the respiratory system doing is working with. And thank you. And the circulatory and the excretory, all the way down into the muscular and the skeletal. So we kind of see how those pairs works and those systems work. Let's stay with the nervous system and skip to 18, and then we can start the first paragraph. And we're just going to read about the intelligence or the nervous system and what he had to say specifically about the nervous system.
the nervous system, and the pattern. Mm-hmm. The nervous system plays a most important role in the physical body. In fact, one could say that it plays the most important role, for all of the other systems are under the direct control of the nervous system.
Mm-hmm.
We have already likened it unto the divine attribute of intelligence, which is the crown of the super incorporeal form of Elohim. It is the nervous system that coordinates all of the other systems into a harmoniously functioning unit, and it can thought of as being the life or spirit of the physical body. For without it, quickening power, the body would be dead. We like to think of the nervous system as denoting spirit, for it plays the same role in quickening the flesh as does the spirit, or Yahweh, in animating material things. It is by means of man's nervous system that he is placed upon the highest plane biological existence.
That's good. So understanding that there's a lot to delve into. If you get a textbook and see how that nervous system trumps all the other systems in our body according to the pattern. Let me see. Reproductive systems.
That's right.
What was that?
So there must be the nervous system. It's got to be connected there in the head, since the head is.
Well, that's what it shows on that page there.
Oh, okay.
That's
okay.
What it shows on the page there on page.
The
36.
Cerebellum or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And it has that stick figure of a man.
The pituitary gland.
Okay.
That's in the back of the head. I think it's up here.
Arborvitae, what is that?
Arborvitae.
It's like branches.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'm not particularly sure what the arterial circle of Willis, you have this. You have the pituitary gland that sits back, like into the Ark of the Covenant. But I'm not going to express that where all the nerves coming from specifically. But they're all attached to them.
The cerebellum and the arborvitae.
Mm-hmm.
And I do believe that that's where it's a branch
like configuration.
Yeah. Yeah,
mm-hmm. Right. Well, that typifying the tree of knowledge, or the tree of life, if you would. And those nervous systems starts within the brain, because they're firing off, and that's what is on that page here.
Okay.
Those are the nervous systems that are coming up, coming from the top.
Mm-hmm.
It tracks all the way down to your bottom. So you stub your toe, you get owie. The muscular system's working with that.
That's amazing.
All the way through. But it's the nervous system that's maintaining. Yeah?
Just to touch on that.
Mm-hmm.
It goes more in depth and specific on that particular part that she's speaking of.
Mm-hmm.
In the pamphlet, the human body, or the tabernacle compared to the human body. So if anybody wants to look that up, that's where they can find that.
Of what? The pamphlet. Yeah.
Compared to the human body, that's where that is specifically stated.
I think that's at the beginning of this.
It might be good to get.
At the beginning of this chapter as well, too. I mean,
it talks about it.
Yeah, tabernacle compared to the physical body.
Yeah, I think so.
Probably in the pamphlet. I know it's got this. I got the pamphlet if you want to pop it.
It has that in the back of the pamphlet.
Mm-hmm.
Let me see if I can
find it. What is it?
Let me see if
I used to have it.
So you talk about the whys and everything?
Take a book of
all the whys in the body.
We
got a new visitor. I mean, on here.
Oh.
My grandson.
Oh.
Awesome.
Wonderful. That's welcome, Eric. Young man. Gospel preached before the end. I don't have it anymore. Where is that?
I might have it.
Did you want it? I got mine in the car.
Never mind, we'll grab it. I think we're going that way.
Compared to
you know, she just give one. To just you have one. Just give it to Eunice, and she can just read off of it. Yeah, he's got it. Yeah. They come and go. Eunice has it. Your arterial circles of Willis.
Is that what it actually is?
Mm-hmm.
Why not have that?
Because Lansing took it off?
No, I ain't got nothing to do with Lansing.
You're talking about man made in the image of Elohim by the pattern of the tabernacle? Let me show you. I haven't put mine together right.
No, that's what I have. It's a small one of the smaller ones.
Talk not about the bales and the different.
Also, the man's bone structure is also showing here.
The what?
The bone structure.
The bone structure.
According to the tabernacle.
Mm-hmm. Or as far as the number of bones?
Yeah.
What page?
Boards and
pillars, yeah.
Pillars.
What page?
206 bones and a body.
Mm-hmm. They equal to the same number of bones and boards and pillars in the tabernacle. What page is that on?
It's before the 56.
56?
The physical one? Oh, okay. I thought you were talking about a smaller one like that.
You have it or no?
Yep.
The skeleton system. Yeah, has to be another class.
Because I know.
Because you got a lot of bones.
I looked that up.
The
okay.
Neck,
okay.
The thoracic vertebrae.
Okay, with the H, yeah.
Can you show me the cover? Physical body. Okay, there it is.
I got them all, man.
Did you send them to me?
I don't know.
I had this lady from.
Can you see that good, Samuel?
Yeah.
All right, just go ahead and skip through there and see what we come up with.
It's going to take me a minute because it's obviously.
Oh, it's 27 pages?
That's a long one.
You said it was a small one.
It's a small pamphlet.
Yeah,
uh-huh.
But it's about
20,
yeah.
Okay. What page are we, what page do you want?
Here's the rest of it.
Tell me what page you
that's a handout from Reggie.
You want, so I can find.
The what? Do you have here?
It's towards the back. 10.
All right.
Oh, with the H?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's just go over that. It's good.
It's going to take a minute for it to load up. I got a lot of processes going on right now.
I'm trying to see. What did I say?
Okay, we got to get going here.
We did.
Took way too much time.
Yeah.
The muscular system and the pattern.
Well, if you guys, all right, so if you guys just can go on, if when it pops up, I'll
yeah, you just notify
put it
me
up on the screen or whatever.
We're all right. We're looking. So recognizing that there is a prescribed way that this tabernacle was put together, right? And it's this way that Moses saw it in a vision, because it's the most written about structure in the Bible. Some 50 plus chapters are dedicated to this tabernacle. And it's by this tabernacle which helps to be a key or pattern of everything in the universe, whereby it's set up as all these charts are set up in a 1-2-3 fashion. In a according to the Mosaic chart here, which is a larger rendition here, this is a greater and more perfect tabernacle. And we have to see that this is the outer court being the Egypt. You have the dividing veil being the first dividing veil being the Red Sea. You have the wilderness of Sinai being like unto the holy place, and you have the River Jordan being the second departmental veil, and then you have the Jerusalem above, Jerusalem, Palestine, if you would, being the most holy place in a type. And it's by this pattern that we go over how the Creator is imaged by His creation according to His Spirit, and how each one of the bones, if you can go into the textbook, and we can sometime we'll do that, go into how all the bones are according to that are in mankind are according to the bones that are in the physical body. I'm going to read this real quick and because it's going to talk about how these bones work a little bit. Is that it?
You got the pamphlet.
Look at you. Look at you. Thank you, Samuel. Samuel, right on it. I'm just going to read this real quick. When Moses, I'm on the textbook.
Mm-hmm.
You can stay what you're doing, Sean. It's fine. 56. When Moses entered into the cloud, which covered Mount Sinai in the year 1940 BY, and saw a vision of Elohim in the super incorporeal form, Exodus 24, 9 and 10, 16 through 17, which form was the temple of his body, John 2, 19. Also, he saw Elohim transform instantaneously into the threefold tabernacle, and he admonished Moses to build the tabernacle in the wilderness, just exactly as the one he saw in the vision, Exodus 25, 8, 9, and 40, and then Hebrews 8 and 5. Moses did construct the tabernacle in the wilderness, and it contained 149 supporting structures called boards, 69 pillars, 60 and bars there were 20. These supporting structures correspond to the bones of a man's physical body. See chapter on structures of bones in the physical body. The answer is simple. When one understands man's physical body is patterned after the Mosaic tabernacle and Solomon's temple, which represents the super incorporeal form that Moses saw in a vision. As the tabernacle was drawn out of the temple, so must the tabernacle be put back into the temple. Moses witnessed the drawing out of the tabernacle from the temple or superincorporeal form in his vision. And after the Israelites had lived in Canaan's land for about 450 years, they began to construct Solomon's temple and the tabernacle, which stood out on Mount Sinai, was dismantled and the furnishings were moved into the temple. 1 Kings 8:1-8. Since the temple of Solomon represents the superincorporeal form of Elohim, we can deduce what makes up the temple of Elohim by knowing the purpose of Yahweh. Since Solomon's temple had a court for the Jews, representing the angelic hosts, and a court for the Gentiles, representing the earthly host, and we know John witnessed too being gathered around the throne or the body of Elohim, Revelations 4:4. Likewise, the Apostle Paul states that the purpose of Yahweh is to gather all that are in heaven, the angelic host, and all that are in the earth, the earthly host, into one body, the temple of Elohim, Ephesians 1:9-10. There is something else that belongs in that temple, which really takes the precedence over everything else. And this is Messiah, the Lamb of Yahweh, who was the first fruits of them that slept. Knowing that the Messiah tarried on earth 33 years, we shall let this 33 represent him. So when we add the 24 representing the elders and the 33 representing the Lamb, we get 57, which must be added to the total of 149 supporting structures of the tabernacle. And this gives us a grand total of 206, which is the number of bones or supporting structures in a man's physical body, which is the temple of Elohim.
What page are you on?
156. And that's really good that you brought that out. And it shows you how that, and it has a picture. You just finally got there, huh?
Yeah, I got it.
That's fine. But it just shows, has a picture here in the textbook. You got the textbook or no?
I do got the textbook. I will pop it up right now.
And what I just read was apropos for having a belief in this tabernacle and how we can see how the boards and the structures of this tabernacle was put together with the 206 bones which are in our body. And you have another chart back there to that effect as well. And seeing where they were placed and how they were placed on there is good to understand. Page 56 of volume 3.
There's not that many pages.
156 of volume 3.
Here we go. Here's page 56. Is this what you're looking for?
Keep going. Volume 3. Actually, they're not. Keep going, though. Because it's at the end of the. Was that the end of the.
It's at the end.
No. I have it. He's just trying to find it on the board.
150. There's only 93 pages.
There's, some of them don't have pages, though.
Yeah.
No, look, there's no page number on there.
Volume 3, page 56.
That's what I had. Okay. There's 53.
You see the tabernacle?
Just keep going to the towards the front. Other way.
Yeah.
Other way.
That's it.
Keep going.
There it is. All right. I'm sorry, everybody.
You're all right.
It's like a long bunch of confusion. There we go.
So that's the tabernacle showing the boat, the boards, pillars, and shows you how many boards there were, how many pillars there were, where they were located, and how many bars there were on the court roundabout, which was, what, 220 pillars long and then 10 pillars wide. Pillars that went across the front of the sanctuary and the ones across from the second departmental veil all the way around. And that number equals the same number of bones in your body. And so to have Yahweh Elohim have that tabernacle being shown unto Moses, and it be a most important structure that we should come and familiar with in order to retain that faith in Yahshua, that there is a divine purpose working it that's at hand, and that we want to embrace that as well. Okay, that's good with that. We can look at, we're going to read, just kind of read through. As aforementioned, it was starting 8 maybe. We're going to do 8a.
You in the pamphlet now?
Yeah. Let's go ahead and just start at 9, I guess. What? Can't find it?
It went away. Oh, there you go.
Thanks, Samuel. I'll give it back to you in the class. I don't know where mine's at. Yeah, I'm going to start at the bottom of 9. This A stands for, or should we start up higher?
That's
the nose. The nose is also very significant. Just to start with the nose on page 8, and we'll just work through there. We have the breath. We understand we can go to Psalms 150 division, the 6th verse. There it talks about, let everything that have breath praise the name of Yahweh, right? Hallelujah. And so it's in there that, you know, we can read down. And now we're going to talk about the nose. And these are things for the new person that we have watching. These are things that are on your body, because we're right. Kind of dealing with the man made in the image of Elohim by the pattern. And we went over the bone structures. We went over the different various 9 furnishings that are in the tabernacle and created and lined them up according to the systems, the 9 primary systems we have in our body. Now we're going to talk about just common things that we have on our face that witness unto Yahshua the Messiah and his father. Okay. The nose.
The nose is also very significant in this wise.
Mm-hmm.
Yahweh is masculine and feminine.
Mm-hmm.
Yah is masculine and way is feminine. That is, he is complete within himself and is fully capable of bringing forth offspring of himself. When he took on a superincorporeal shape and form in the manifestation of Elohim, he still was masculine and feminine.
Mm-hmm.
Elohim is a plural title meaning masculine and feminine.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, when he made a physical man, Adam, in his likeness and image, mm-hmm. he also must be masculine and feminine.
Or another word can be, he was an hermaphrodite, having both male and female within his loins, right? Mm-hmm. Go ahead and read.
So Eve was in Adam when he was created.
Uh-huh.
The name Yahweh is derived from the tetragrammaton, YHWH,
uh-huh.
4 consonants, which cannot be pronounced.
Because you need a vowel in order to pronounce that. That's not a word that we would typically know, but yet the Hebrew, and they wrote in Hebrew because Hebrew is a pictorial language, right? So they would automatically understand what this tetragrammaton mean in their language. Mm-hmm. Read.
There has been some debate among authorities as to what vowels should be added to make the name pronounceable. If Adam and Eve were made in the likeness of Yahweh, mm-hmm, and were the visible expression of Yahweh,
yes,
then
go ahead.
Then we see that the name Adam only contains one vowel, an A.
Right. And so we've done this before. We have we're talking here about Adam. A-D-A-M, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we're talking specifically about this A. And it's because it's a witness, this double A, which is the first vowel in our language, A-E-I-O-N-U, is expressing here that Yahweh using the A to put in the masculine portion of his name, of Yahweh. Okay, read.
Which we insert in the masculine portion of the tetragrammaton, making it Yah. And the name Eve only has one vowel, an E.
So again, Eve, being the mother of us all, has one vowel, which is an E, but it's doubled up within the name. Mm-hmm. Same way Adam was created is why we have the E in the feminine portion of the name of Yahweh, denoting the feminine portion of Yahweh. So now that's how we're able to come into the term or the name of Yahweh to make the tetragrammaton pronounceable.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
Which we insert into the female portion mm-hmm of the tetragrammaton, making it way.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if we examine the nose, we find it proof of the fact that these are the proper vowels to insert into the tetragrammaton, for the triangular shape of the nose is the shape of an A.
Mm-hmm. And so looking at it from the top portion down, you're going to have, you're showing that on the screen there, huh? Mm-hmm. Okay, we're good, so I don't have to do my horrible drawing. So we're good. Thank you, Sean, for that double up witness. Keep going.
And the junction of the upper bony part of the nose with the lower cartilage part forms the crossbar or bridge of the letter A.
Wow. Okay.
This A stands for Adam. And since Eve was in Adam, then one must find an E within the A of the nose.
Okay.
The nostril being divided by a septus gives us the configuration of an E thusly. Mm-hmm. This settles the argument of what vowels to insert into the tetragrammaton to make it Yahweh.
I ain't seen that for years. It's been a long time since I've seen that.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah.
Now I've got to go find my book. Cause I'm where is that? Because I didn't forget about that. But go ahead.
While we are discussing the subject of the tetragrammaton, YHWH, let us point out undeniable proof for the existence of the other consonants besides the Y in our physical bodies.
Mm-hmm.
The letter H is very plainly shown by extending the arms vertically above the head so that each arm becomes an extension of the leg on each side of the body, thus forming the two vertical posts of the letter H, the rest of the body being situated between these two vertical posts would be the crossbar of the H in this fashion.
Very nice.
Because
we usually do Y, we knew YMCA and all of that, but then you space it out how the picture's drawn there,
right.
We can see how that becomes an H.
Yeah.
Go ahead and read.
Inwardly, the letter H is very vividly displayed in the shape of the brain as it is made up principally of right and left hemispheres, mm-hmm. which form the vertical parts of the letter H, and the corpus callosum mm-hmm. of the brain, which connects the right and left hemispheres mm-hmm. together, would be the crossbar of the letter H. Thusly.
Hmm. And so awesome. Right here on this chart here, we're talking about the corpus callosum is this parts here. I don't know if you can zoom in on this right here. You have the cross parts that connect the right and left hemisphere. Because understanding that these right and left hemispheres, they're not touching one another.
Right.
And that's being witnessed into the two... The two archangels here, if you can zoom in here, you're seeing that their wings did not touch neither. So we understand that Michael was the warrior, or according to the left hemisphere, was a motory mm-hmm. portion of the brain. And then Gabriel, being the other archangels, it was a messenger. And so we have a... motor and sensory part of the brain, the one that does the writing and more literal things, right? So those are the two witnesses within one's body, and why we talk about the corpus callosum here. That's what they was talking about. Keep reading. To show the H principle.
Furthermore, the letter H is most dramatically displayed in a cross-section of the spinal cord and is spoken of in the various textbooks of anatomy, but I have never read of any author explanation of its presence. The letter H is form of the gray matter of the cord with the white matter surrounding it thusly. The last consonant to be considered is the W, and there has been much controversy as to whether this should be V rather than a W.
Uh-oh.
Any student of language knows that there is a close relationship between the letter V of our alphabet and the letter U, and that the letter V was first in its appearance. Later, the letter W appeared, which is a double U or a ligature of VV or W, well, UU. Mm-hmm. We see this letter V in the word Eve, who was the female counterpart of Adam, mm-hmm. the first physical man who literally died for his bride mm-hmm. by willfully partaking of the forbidden fruit.
Mm-hmm.
The Apostle Saul states that Adam was not deceived.
Yes.
But the woman, Eve, was deceived by the serpent and was in the transgression. Thus, the first physical man, Adam, was a figure of the second Adam, Yahshua, the Messiah, who willfully died on the cross for his bride, the whole world.
Hmm.
Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, mm-hmm. who is the figure of him that was to come. Now, when Yahshua the Messiah, the second Adam, did appear, he was called the Lamb of Yahweh in fulfillment of the Lamb that was sacrificed in Egypt at the original Passover,
mm-hmm.
Exodus. And the lamb sacrificed in the Mosaic tabernacle on the brazen altar of sacrifice in the outer court. A female lamb is called a ewe. Here one can see that as the letter V was a forerunner of the letter W and are closely related, likewise Eve or the woman was the forerunner of the Messiah. The Eve or the Lamb, as the Apostle Saul states, for as the woman is of the man, even so is the man also by the woman. The letter W of the Tetragrammaton actually comes to us through the process of simplified transliteration or the substitution of the closest letter of one alphabet for a letter of another alphabet, which translating from one language to another. Thus, YHVH becomes YHWH, and we have proof of the W or the VVW, U or V in the makeup of our physical body. Here again, by raising our arms above our heads and spreading them apart to form a V and spreading the legs apart, we have a WV, double V, thusly. Likewise, the face shows this double V, W, with the arching of the eyebrows and the triangular shape of the nose, thusly. Wow. Besides our eyes and our nose, we have a mouth that is situated just below the nose, and the upper lip of this mouth is heart-shaped. And the breath of life that we have breathed into our bodies is expelled through the mouth in the act of forming words or speaking. Our mouths speak words according to the contents or the dictates of our reservoir of our knowledge, the brain.
That's, and they're talking about that nervous system or the intelligence of what that brain represents. Now, we can come back and we can maybe visit this rest of this pamphlet. There's not much more there, but I know our time is short. So just to kind of wrap, you know, 5 minutes. What else you got there?
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, let me just wrap it up, because we got to highlight the big parts of what I wanted to get to, ideally, being the tabernacle, the furnishings in it, the steps in the tabernacle, how it correlates to nine primary systems in our body, and how it works with the nine primary divine attributes that are expressed here, and how they are put in a logical and a systematic way as far as being set up within the creation, and how the creation evolves and comes about with the death or the fall season, the winter season being a burial, and then you have the spring season being the resurrection, and you have summer being the ascension, if you would, or the fruition, as we have here on this chart depicting that same season event that is particular and is perfect in how it was set up. And understanding that Yahweh our Elohim did all of that before he stepped into it, because he created an angelic and physical creation. And then when he divested of himself and became as Yahweh Elohim, a lower, lesser degree, not pure spirit, but a super incorporeal being by which we can learn of. And we began to learn of him, Moses did, by way of a vision. And when he did manifest down here in Egypt first, when he began to institute, and they knew not who Yahshua the Messiah was, because everything was imposed upon him. It wasn't until the fourth dispensation. The fourth dispensation is when the Messiah came in, and he was able to fill up those seven branches, if you would, of this candlestick and light it up every man of the world. And understanding that now, in this dispensation, the sixth dispensation, that we can see into and have a confidence about one Yahshua the Messiah. And when we are able to see and believe with all faith, just as Job had it with all faith. You have Job right there, open up.
It won't take me that long.
If we can see Yahweh, and again, Job, as we're going to read just the first verse, is what we're going to see, and how having this knowledge that we've come to learn by way of our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, that we can have some confidence that might be a little bit of grain that Job has here. Read.
Job 1. Mm-hmm. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, And that man was perfect and upright, mm-hmm. and one that feared Elohim, mm-hmm. and eschewed evil.
And eschewed evil. He stayed away from evil and did all those things in a perfect way, in a perfect conscience. You got Colossians 1 and 28.
Colossians 1:28,
uh-huh.
whom we preach, yes. warning every man, yes. and teaching every man in his all wisdom.
And we're teaching them according to the chart. So we went over the day with the tabernacle in order to bring them some wisdom. Having the fear of Yahweh be your wisdom. We have a fear in this triad of intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge. You have to have a fear of Yahweh Elohim, just like Job did, read.
That we may present every yes. man perfect.
As Job was considered perfect as well. You see? So when you can see how the law and the prophets work together in order to pull out, we can have an understanding that can be perfect. In order to do what? Read.
Perfect in Yahshua the Messiah.
Uh-huh.
Whereunto I also labor, yes. striving according to his working, which worketh in me mightily.
And that works within any man, because that perfectness is going to be in Yahshua the Messiah. If you got anything at all that's been said today, all praises and honor goes to our Father, Yahweh our Elohim, by way of Yahshua the Messiah. And with that, I'll conclude. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let's start it back. Thank you, Dr. Love. That will conclude this evening's lecture. Do we have any announcements? No? Okay. We'd like to thank all of you for coming out and studying with us out there on YouTube or Facebook, and those who come to visit us here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California. We hold classes here on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Let us all stand now to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever, let us all say, Hallelujah.